invited the Spirit to come. Here. We told him that we're hanging on every word that he would speak. He knows your heart. That Spirit that you just sang of inspired people to write his word. And so if you're ready to hear his word spoken to you, just say, I'm ready. Lord, we do ask that you would speak to us. We hold your word in high regard. We thank you for preserving it all these years, that we might be blessed with the opportunity to cast our eyes upon it and open up our hearts to it. We ask you, Spirit of God, that you would lead us into all truth and to take away any preconceived notions we may have and replace them with your truth. We thank you, Spirit. We thank you for the job description you've given yourself that is guaranteed that you would meet us and teach us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you're ready to hear from the Spirit of God, do me a favor and open up a copy of God's Word. You'll see them all over the sanctuary, in the seat back in front of you, or on the tables. If you have your own, awesome. You rock. Let's open our Bibles to Luke chapter 2. As you're turning there, I want to remind you that we're going to be, let me let you know we're going to be reading starting in verse 41. We started a message series a few weeks back going through the Gospel of Luke so we could partner with Jesus as he builds his church. And he said he's going to. It's going to grow. It's going to win. And I want to be a part of that. Amen? I want to be a part of that. And I believe that you want to be a part of that, or you wouldn't be here tonight. A lot of other things you could do. Well, he told us how to do this. He said, this is how I want you to partner with me to build my church. He said, if you lift me up, if you exalt me, Jesus said, if you exalt me, I'll draw people to myself. And that's what we've been doing. We've been going through the Gospel of Luke, and we've been exalting Jesus. We're just talking about Jesus. We're learning about Jesus because we want to worship Jesus with all of our spirit, right? I don't know about you, but I kind of peaked. I peaked out when we were singing. Can you turn me down a little bit? When we were singing, I peaked out, and I just want to tell you, as someone who like desperately loves you, and you can take this any way that you choose to take it, but I want to just say that I think that some of us need to learn to stand in the presence of the King. I think that some of us need to hold the Lord in a little higher regard than maybe we do. And I'm just throwing that out there, and you can let the Spirit of God do with it as he wishes. But we've been going through the Gospel of Luke, and we're just lifting up Jesus so that we could worship him in spirit and in truth. And the only way we can release this spirit, these emotions that God has given to us, the only way we can release them properly to the right God is to have some truth so we can understand who God really is. And when you understand who God really is, let me tell you something. You can't help but worship him. Amen. You can't help it. And so you got to get to know him, right? You got to get to know him. So I'm going to read something with you, and then we'll dive into it. Tim, would you do me a favor? My dear, my love, my friend, could you turn these on as well? These two? Thank you. I'm getting a little bit older, and I have a hard time reading without the proper lighting. So I'm going to start, but I know that it's going to help as the lights come on. But we're going to start in Luke chapter 2, verse 41, and we're going to let the Spirit of God speak to you, okay? He said you're ready. Here we are. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. Thank you. When Jesus was 12 years old, they attended the festival as usual. After the celebration was over, they started home to Nazareth, but Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents didn't miss him at first because they assumed he was among the other travelers. But when he didn't show up that evening, they started looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they couldn't find him, they went back to Jerusalem to search for him there. 3 days later, they finally discovered him at the temple, sitting among the religious leaders, listening to them and asking questions. All who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. Now, before I finish this chapter, I have to pause. Like, I don't know about you, but I am a forgetful person. Anyone in here ever lost their keys? Raise your hand. Anyone? You're all liars if you haven't. You know you've lost your keys. Okay, Daisy, this one's for you. You ready? Anyone ever lose their cell phone? Raise your hand. Raise all 10 of your hands. Yeah, right? I've lost all kinds of things. The thing I miss most is my mind. I lost that a long time ago. But listen, this is awesome. This is a whole new level of depravity. Mary and Joseph lost God. Like, can you imagine that? They lost Jesus. That is a whole new level of low, and God used them to show us faith. The people who lost God. That's kind of crazy, right? So he's in the temple. He's hanging out with all the religious dudes, and they're having a discussion about the Word of God. And so the parents speak up, and his parents didn't know what to think about how he was acting in the temple and the fact that he was gone and that there he was. And so they say, "Son," his mother said to him, "why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been frantic, searching for you everywhere." And Jesus responds, "But why did you need to search?" He asked, "Didn't you know that I must be in my father's house?" Some translations say, "Didn't you know I'd be about my father's business?" But they didn't understand what he meant. His parents are confused. And then he returned to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. And his mother stored all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and all the people. Now, there's a whole lot of things we could talk about in that text, but there's something that this text introduces to us that is a major, major Christian doctrine that you have to have. And it's confusing, though. I'm confused by what I read there, and a lot of people are. You know what else confuses me? Well, a lot of things, but FaceTime confuses me. I don't understand how FaceTime works. Everyone say hello to Kyle. You guys remember Kyle?
Is that my sister?
Did you hear what Jared just said? I just want to point that out. Yeah, you choose to ignore it? Yeah. Well practiced? Yeah. So here's the thing that kind of freaks me out, right? Yeah, there's Aria. Yeah. Where's mommy? Where's Jamie? Hey, mommy. Hey, everybody. There's Jamie. Hey. Okay, so this is what freaks me out, right? What freaks me out is that how far away are you think, Kyle?
1,000 miles.
1,000 miles. So he's 1,000 miles away from us, and somehow his little phone is able to capture what's going on in his living room and then make it disappear and float. Right. She's getting ready for their worship team. It's kind of hard to do when you're being that cute. So somehow, they're not going to listen to a word I'm saying if you don't stop. So somehow, this what's going on 1,000 miles away can be condensed in this phone of theirs, sent off into the nothing, and it's invisible, and it knows where to go. It knows what towers to go to, and it knows to come to this phone, and it's invisible. So like right now, what's freaking me out is that around us that we can't see is a bunch of FaceTime conversations of people all over the world, and you can't see them. And somehow, this, which is happening 1,000 miles away, within a split second, it shows back up into my phone. And somehow, this phone has the ability to take that invisible wave and make it exactly what's happening in their living room, 1,000 miles away, that second. Now, my brain is not intelligent enough to figure out this thing, right? That freaks me out. But I got to tell you something. It is, though, right? Like, that's them. Would you agree? There's Kyle, Jamie, and Aria. There they all are. It's happening right now. Can anyone tell me exactly how that's happening? But it does, right? Thanks, dude. Talk to you later. Say bye, everyone.
Bye.
See you in October.
Yeah.
Later. See you, bro. Okay, so that freaks me out, but I know I don't understand how it works, but I know that it happens. And this right here, this text, this opens up something that is a foundational doctrine of the faith that's very confusing, but it's here. I'm going to go over three things with you tonight that you got to get. If you're going to worship Jesus in spirit and in truth, these are some truth. You have to have this so you can worship him well and correctly. Amen? Okay, so the first thing is who Jesus is. Now listen, a lot of people might say, who was Jesus? You might see covers of magazines that say, who is Jesus? But listen, it can't be who was Jesus. It's who is Jesus. That's a critical switch of a word. It's who is Jesus, right? Is the present tense. And you have to understand that. It's the present tense. It's not who he was 2,000 years ago. It's who he is right now. The gospel, if you open up the gospels, it'll teach you that Jesus was before the beginning. Now, I don't even understand what that means. Because my brain is trapped between the beginning and the end, and I don't understand beyond that. Do you understand, right? So, but the Bible says in John chapter 1 that in the beginning, which I don't even know what that is, so don't ask me. In the beginning, there was the Word. And it doesn't say what the Word is yet, but it says that there was this Word. And the Word was with God, and it was God. And the Word gave life to everything. And then in verse 14, it says something that's amazing. It says that Word, it starts to clarify who it is, because we have hindsight. That Word put on skin and dwelt among us. So Jesus Christ was not just born in the stable in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago, and we celebrate Christmas. Now, we understand that he was born in the stable, but the Bible says that he was already before that. He was born. He grew up, right? It says that he went home with his parents. He grew in wisdom. So Jesus, who was 12 years old at this time, he was once a spirit you couldn't see, and then he was a baby born in the stable, and then he was 12 years old in the temple, and then he became a teenager, the only one that was well-behaved ever. He became a teenager, he became a young adult, he was a carpenter's apprentice for his father, and he became a rabbi, and he grew up, he was an adult, and he began to teach. Jesus grew. He was a person. He was flesh. He grew up, and then he was falsely accused. And then he was crucified up on the cross. And then he actually died. And then he actually went to the grave, and he actually rose again. Hebrews 7:24 says that Jesus lives forever and that his role of Savior will last forever. He is our interceding priest. When he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one gets to the Father except through him, that wasn't past tense. That's right now. If you want access to the Father, you have to do it through Jesus. He's the priest that stands between you and God. And when God looks at you and he sees our sin, Jesus goes, hey, whoa, whoa, whoa. He's with me. My blood's on him. And he lets him in. That's what he sees. He's the priest, but look, he lives. That's a great place for an amen. He lives forever. That's not just past tense. So that's why we have to say who is Jesus. When we talk about Christ, we can't talk about who he was. We talk about who he is. Who he is. And so who is Jesus? Well, let me just tell you. In Luke chapter 3, Jesus gets baptized. He goes to John the Baptist and he gets baptized. So John the Baptist lowers him down into the water. I mean, I baptized some people in my day, man. It's always a joy and a thrill. Can you imagine baptizing Jesus? That's just rocking, right? What did you do today? I baptized Jesus. Top that, yo. Right? I mean, seriously, right? So he baptizes Jesus. What does he say? I baptize you in you. Like, what do you do there, right? So a little confusing. So he baptizes Jesus, and Jesus, he's coming up out of the water, right? And listen, there's a voice from heaven. Like, God the sovereign speaks, and everyone hears it, and it says, that is my dearly loved son who I'm well pleased. That's what God the Father said, right? That's his kid. That's my son. So what does that mean? That God says, he's got a father in heaven, right? And then, later on in Jesus' life, he grows up. He starts his ministry. And I think I got a pretty good thing going here with you guys. We're doing good. It's a good, healthy church. I love you all. Jesus, he's got a pretty good ministry going, I think. He's up on a hill, and he's praying with Peter, James, and John. So they're all hanging out with him, right? And they turn around, and Jesus is glowing. I mean, no offense, guys. This was a good song. We had some really cool lighting. Jesus was glowing, right? He's glowing. And they're like freaked out, I'm sure, right? And as if that wasn't enough to wet your depends, right? Moses, who's been dead for 1,500 years, and Elijah, who's been dead for almost 1,000 years, they show up. These are Mount Everests of the faith. This is Moses. This is the guy who came down from Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments in his hand. This is Moses who took the nation of Israel through the open Red Sea. This is Elijah who prayed and called down fire from heaven. These are monsters of these people's faith. And the voice comes again. Because these guys are awesome. And we may idolize them a bit, and the voice shows up again. And just to clarify things, the Father says to those disciples who are standing in the presence of Jesus, Moses, and Elijah, and he says, that's my son. Listen to him. Now just think for a second. The greatest leader in the history of mankind, Moses, They loved his law. They followed his law to the letter. The greater you followed the law, the greater of a Jew you were. And he was everything. And in the presence of Moses, God the Father says, Heisman to Moses, that's my son. Listen to him. That's his father. So two times he says, that's my son. So we have to understand that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He's the Son of God. He is deity. But at the same time, this is where it's confusing. At the same time, here's Mary and Joseph with Jesus. They're in the temple, and mom says to him, your father and I, why would you do that to your father and I? Well, the Bible says that he has a father, but yet the Bible also says that he's got another father. He's got a mother and a father. So what's happening here is we're presented for the first time this unique person of Jesus Christ, who is 100% God and 100% man. And when I'm talking about FaceTime, I don't understand how Kyle's picture shows up here instantly on my phone. And I don't understand this because nobody else is that. It's beyond our understanding. It's like, explain the Trinity to me, Beth. Like, you can't. Explain to me that he was the Word, that he was with God and he is God. I don't understand. Explain to me that he's the Son of God and the Son of people. I don't understand that. But I know what? He is. Amen. He is. And you just have to understand that. Luke 2:52 says that he is a human that grew in wisdom. He grew in stature. I don't know if that meant physical or if it meant amongst the people. He grew in favor with God. God used him in increasing ways as he got older and his ministry expanded. He did greater and greater things and he grew in favor with man. People would listen to him more and more and more as time went on. But you know what else? It's not just that he was a young man who grew into adulthood and had a great ministry going. The Bible in Colossians 1 says that this same Jesus who was in Mary and came out of his mom, just like we've got baby right there, brand new baby right there, little Oakley, all kinds of babies, right? We were all babies at one point, and Jesus was a baby, and he was born from Mary, but the Bible doesn't leave it there. The Bible says in Colossians 1 that he's the visible image of the invisible God. That he is the head of the church. That he is that actually Jesus Christ is the creator. And that he is the sustainer of all things. That's Jesus Christ the Lord. You know, I found this to be interesting. I don't know if you guys do. Maybe it's my little warped brain, but do me a favor. Stand up for a second. Stand up. Everyone stand up. Stand up. It's real quick. Real quick. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to, on the count of three, I just want you to jump up. Just one time. It doesn't have to be big. If you're able. Just jump, okay? And then just tell me when it, just do that. Right? One, two, three. Okay. What happened? You came down. What is that? Gravity, right? That's what scientists say. Okay, you can have a seat. You did great, by the way. Awesome, right? Amazing group. Super, not every church could have pulled that off, I'm just telling you right now. Gravity, right? So things that go up are sucked back down into the core of the planet. That's gravity, right? Do you agree? Okay. Did you know that right now, as you sit here, in the atmosphere that surrounds this earth, there are 37.5 million billion gallons of water. What did God say about a flood? Anyone ever read the Bible? He said he'd never do it again. Now listen, you just agreed that things are sucked down into the core of our planet. There are 37.5 million billion gallons of water surrounding our earth right now. Do you know what 37.5 million is? Say no, you don't. Right? Because that's a mind-boggling number. 37.5 million is that. Right? Isn't that what that is? 37.5 million, right? That's a lot. That's a big number, isn't it? Do you know what a billion, do this with me. We've done this before. It's so much fun. A billion, right? It's a billion. Let me see what a billion looks like. Okay. That's massive, right? Now think about this. There are 37.5 million of those in the atmosphere right now that would flood the entire earth. Do you know how much water that is? I did the math. It's that much. That's enough to flood the earth. But God said, I won't do it again. And the scripture is true. Like you could science me to death, But God's word says that Jesus Christ is holding all creation together. And the reason why that doesn't flood this earth right now is because Jesus Christ said stop, and it didn't. That's why. That's Jesus Christ. So the Bible says that Jesus is this, and the Bible says that Jesus is that. And you go to Google, and it'll be all kinds of different things about who Jesus is and was and will be and all that kind of stuff. Various religions and philosophies will offer up their opinion of Jesus as a prophet or a highly moral teacher. But listen, loved ones, at the end of the day, and I'm not discounting the Bible because you know I feel about the Word of God, but at the end of the day, the Bible's perspective and my perspective and Oprah's perspective and Trump's perspective and Hillary's perspective and the Pope's perspective, they don't matter. There's only one perspective that really matters. And Jesus Christ makes it quite clear that this one singular perspective is the most important thing, and he pushes it to the forefront of discussion with his disciples. And you'll see it in Luke chapter 9. You can turn there if you will. So Jesus is hanging out with all these crowds of people. He's got this rocking ministry right now, and he leaves the crowd to pray alone, and he just takes his 12 disciples with him. And he's standing around, and I don't know the exact setting because it doesn't say, but let's just say he's standing right here, and he's got 12 guys along with him. And he's got all these people around him, right, these disciples, and he asks them this question: who do people say that I am? And I just mentioned to you about the different religions and the different cults and the different websites and all these different people will say, well, you're this and you're that and you're this and you're that. And everyone has their own opinion. So Jesus says, listen, I want you to put all the cards on the table right now. Tell me who everybody says that I am. And so they start listing off various people. They think, well, maybe you're Elijah, or maybe you're John the Baptist, or maybe you're one of the other prophets. You know, they're just listing them all, just like I did. But then he cuts right through it. He goes right after their heart. He says, listen, it doesn't matter what everybody else thinks. Who do you think I am? Who do you think that I am? That's the only perspective that matters, because that's that singular choice that is unique to only you is going to determine your forever. And it doesn't make any difference what I stand up here and present to you. I have my own belief system. You got yours? You got yours? Your decision decided where you're going to go forever. Mine isn't. That's not up to me. So the singular question that matters most is, who is Jesus to you? And I'm going to give you an opportunity to make that choice in just a few moments as you listen to God's word. Well, Peter answers. He says, you're the Messiah. You're the Christ. You're the anointed one. And he's right. And the clear teaching of the entirety of Scripture, the entirety of God's Word, is that Jesus Christ is unique and that he is both man and God. And listen, you cannot worship him unless you get that. You can't say that he is deity, but he's not man. You cannot say he is man, but he is not deity. To worship Jesus correctly, you have to understand. You have to let that truth that he is 100% man and 100% God buried down into the deepest part of your heart, buried down into the deepest part of your brain. Your understanding must be that he is God and man. You have to understand this. You have to understand this. Colossians 2:9 says, this is an amazing, amazing verse. Colossians 2:9 says that for in Christ dwelt the fullness of God in a human body. Now, you have to understand that when Jesus was before, in the beginning, Jesus was Lord, 100%. When he was born in the stable with Mary, he was Lord. When he was in the temple 12 years old, he was Lord. When he was crucified on the cross, he was Lord. When he went to the grave, he was Lord. When he rose again, he was Lord. When he ascended to heaven, he was Lord. And right now, he is Lord. Amen. There's no changing that. And at no time was Jesus Christ ever was his deity diminished in any way. There's a teaching popular around the earth that somehow Jesus was diminished in some capacity when he came here because he was submitting to the authority of the Father. Well, the Bible says that I and the Father are one. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father, that the fullness of God was pleased to dwell in Christ. The fullness, everything that God is, was present, is present, and will be present in the person of Jesus Christ the Lord. And that does not change ever. You have to understand this. He is not diminished in any way, ever. And so I ask you, who do you say Jesus is? Who do you, doesn't matter about the person next to you, who do you say Jesus is? You know, in church, you wait to the end, right? Got this program we do, and you wait to the end, and you really set them up high, and then you come in with the left hook, and you offer them Jesus, and you hope they get saved. I don't believe in all that all the time, you know? I mean, we just got to do what we believe the Spirit of God is leading us to do, right? I'm going to tell you right now, I'm giving you the opportunity to make the choice right now. Who do you say Jesus Christ is? If you've never agreed that he is Christ, that he is the Messiah, that he is the anointed one of God, that he is God who put on skin and came on his own free will to rescue you. If you believe that, you're saved. And if you've never made that choice, because no one can make you do it. If you've never made that choice, what you feel right now is his hand on your back. You feel his hand on your hand so that you can say yes. He just wants to lead you. If you want to say yes, just say yes. Who cares what anyone else thinks? If you're a Christian and you're part of this church, I can tell you, if you're not a Christian, we would be so psyched if you were. Like, I make no bones about it. The only reason we're here is so you'll say yes. That's why we're here. Give you the good news so you might say yes, because we want to hang out with you in heaven forever. If we just met you just tonight, then listen, that would stink if it was only a one shot. Let's not make this a one night stand, right? Let's make this a love relationship forever. So if you want to say yes, that's all you got to do is just agree. Just say, listen, Lord Jesus, yes, you are God, and I need you to save me. Like, that's a simple enough prayer. You don't even have to quote King James. You just got to say yes. Okay. Who is Jesus? Okay, so the first thing, and listen, you could do that at any time. Listen, I don't know what any other church may have taught you about the way you have to go about getting saved, and maybe you got to go to the priest, or maybe you got to go into the confession booth, or maybe you got to come to the altar. Listen, this is not the altar. The altar is closed. Jesus already put the sacrifice of himself up there, and there wasn't a need for any more. There's no real altar here. You just got to say yes. Here's an altar right here. It's on your heart. You just got to say it right here. Just say yes. That's it. Okay? And you can do that anytime. If he wakes you up, if you feel his hand on your back at 3:00 this morning saying, let's dance, do it then. Okay? Anytime. So we know who Jesus is. There's so much more. We could talk about that for a month, but let's move on. Here's the second thing. If you're a note taker, I love you so very much. What did Jesus teach us? And I'm not talking about in the temple, in the church, at the pulpit, on the hillside, in front of the people, like I'm standing here right now, like teaching something. That's not what I'm talking about. He did a lot of that, and we're going to spend the next year doing most of that. This red writing, that he's teaching stuff right out of his mouth. I'm not talking about that in this text. What I'm talking about in this text is, what does his life, His actions teach us. And this is so important. Like, you got to get this. Because, listen, God has a, you've heard this before, God has a plan for your life. Have you ever heard anyone say that? You're about to hear it again. Look at your neighbor and say, God has a plan for your life. Now, as if that wasn't uncomfortable enough, I want you to look back at that person, right, and say, and it's a good one. Okay? You guys did great. Listen, here's the thing. Every preacher says God's got a plan for your life. Everyone. And I'm included in that, right? I'm lame. I can't come up with anything new. I don't know, listen, about the plan for your life. I don't know what that plan is. Because it's going to, like, there's 7 billion people in this world. There's, I don't know how many people in this room right now, but 50, 60 people, but you have, God has a plan for your life, but it's going to flesh out in a different way. You're going to do one thing, and you're going to do another thing, and we're all going to have our different gifts and talents and what God calls us to do this, and some of you are going to go to the mission field, and some of you are going to do this, and some of you are going to do that. We're going to have different things for different people. I don't know how it's going to flesh out. So when I say God has a plan for you, I can't tell you specifically what that will look like. But I do know one thing that is across the board for every single one of you. If you've bowed your knee to Jesus, I know that there's a plan, and here's the plan. Romans 8:29 says it is God's desire that you would be conformed into the image of Christ. That's his plan for your life. Now, what you'll do after that, I don't know. But his plan for your life is to be conformed into the image of Christ. Now, listen. Don't blow that off. That's a big deal. A moment ago, I shared with you the Bible, that in the Bible where it says in Colossians that Christ was the visible image of the invisible God, right? What's that mean? We talked about that a moment ago, that everything that God is in his entirety was pleased to dwell in Christ. If you want to know about God, you look at Jesus. If you want to know God's heart, look at Jesus' heart. You want to know God's feelings, look at Jesus' feelings. You want to know God's words, listen to Christ. Every single thing about Jesus is every single thing about God. And so it's the exact likeness of this God, this sovereign king that no one has ever seen, because if you see him, you die. And so God is so gracious, he sends a visual aid in the person of Jesus. So when you see Jesus, you see the entirety of God. That's what it means to be in the image of his Father. Do you feel it now? Are you feeling that kind of a little bit of a pressure? Because it's God's desire that you would be conformed into the exact likeness of Jesus Christ. See, Jesus had the deck stacked against us. He was, when he was born in that barn, he was already 100% God. You're not. You're not even close. There's the good news. And so what God is trying to do now in you is he's trying to take this sin nature that we inherited from Adam and Eve, and he's trying to work on that to conform it, to mold it into the visible image of the invisible Christ. We can't see him now. He's ascended to heaven. So he wants to take you and make you the image bearer of Jesus. That's a privilege, an honor. It's also hard work, right? But be assured of this, the one who began a good work in you will continue it to its completion. The reason why I mention this is that we're talking about what did Jesus teach. And so if it's important to Jesus Christ, and he displayed something in his life, then it should be important to us. If he's making a practice of something in his own flesh, then that's what we should be doing, because we're to be conformed into his image. So here's two things right from the text that you'll see that Jesus taught with his life. One is priorities, and the second is obedience. Talking about priorities, let me give you some stats. These are staggering. The Nielsen people who live, breathe, go to the bathroom, cook, everything TV. You know, the Nielsen ratings, you know what I'm talking about? The Nielsen ratings say that the average American who's older than 2 years old watches 34 hours a week of television. The Gallup company, the ones who do the polls, like when people are leaving where the election polls and stuff, they do ballots, straw ballots and stuff like that. The Gallup organization said that the typical American worker now, no longer 40 hours used to be full time, the typical American worker now works 47 hours a week. The typical average American, and some of you are going to be on different ends of this scale, right? Sleep 53 hours a week. I didn't say month, I said week. So some of us go to bed early and then wake up at the crack of noon with bedhead, just enough to eat some Doritos and go back to sleep. So that's what's pushing it way up. And then there's guys like Jared who sleep about an hour and a half a day. Okay? So somewhere in the middle, we've got 53 hours a week that the average American is sleeping. The average American spends 17 and a half hours a week on sports and leisure. There's 168 hours in a week, and I just told you 151 of them are already occupied. And listen, you haven't cooked anything, you haven't cleaned anything, you haven't driven a child to school, you haven't driven to the store to buy something, you haven't combed your hair, you haven't shaved, you haven't brushed your teeth, you haven't done anything yet, and you're at 151 hours, and you only got 168 in a week. It's a good question. Am I living the way I should? Because if you noticed, I haven't mentioned God in those numbers at all. But Jesus, his life, says something about priorities. Here's Jesus Christ at age 12. Now, in that culture, you were considered a man at 13. You had your bar mitzvah, and you became a man. But at 12 years old, here is Jesus Christ. He is displaying proper priorities of the godly. That's what Jesus Christ is doing. Look what he says. He says, why did you even need to search for me? Didn't you know? Oh, well, of course this is where I'm going to be. I mean, are you surprised that I'm at church? Are you guys surprised about this? And Jesus is like, no, that's what I do. What does he do? He's studying the Word of God that he wrote. He's listening to the Word of God. He's sitting there with the religious leaders, and he's a 12-year-old kid, right? He's a 12-year-old little boy sitting in church, studying the Word of God, sharing the Word of God, listening, asking, answering at church, in God's house, conducting his Father's business. He's all in on the ministry. That's what Jesus Christ is doing. And he looks at his parents, and he says, of course. I can listen. This is conjecture. That's the Bible. I'm sure I would say, Mom, Dad, why aren't you doing that? Of course that's what we're doing. Of course that's what I'm doing. Why did you even need to look for me? Of course I'm at church sharing God's word. That's what Christians do. This is the ministry of the church, and that's why the Bible makes it quite clear that the job of the leaders in the church in Ephesians 4 is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. That's what I'm doing right now. I'm presenting to you God's word so that you can, just like Jesus, make his ministry the priority of your life, studying God's word, sharing God's word with other people. That's the priority of your life. Don't you know that? What are you doing with your 168 hours? Jesus made it quite clear what you're supposed to do. This is the priority of Christ, and so it must be the priority of the Christian. Here, this is awesome. Luke chapter 9, verse 23 is the coolest verse. This is what it says. Jesus explains to people, he clearly states that if you're going to be my follower, this is what he says. You must turn from your selfish ways, right? Me, mine, I, me, my job, my car, my house, my stuff, my money, my career, even my family. Me, my. That's the stuff that's most important. He says you have to turn from this. The next thing he says is you got to pick up your cross, and theologians and commentators fight about what that is, and so I don't really know what that means in its entirety, so let's not dwell there, but let's dwell on the thing that is obvious. He said, if you want to be my follower, turn from your selfish ways and follow me. That's like answering a word definition with the same word. If you want to follow me, follow me. He doesn't go into great detail, does he? If you want to be my follower, put your own stuff down and follow me. This is a profound statement. Christ's followers follow Christ. That's what they do. They do what he does. They say what he says. They love the way he loves. They forgive the way he forgives. They have compassion the way he has compassion. They spend time in the ministry like he did. They study the word of God like he did. They shared the word of God like he does. If you want to be my follower, follow me. Follow my example. This is what I'm doing. Do as I say and as I do. See, a lot of us can't do that, especially as parents. Can't always make that statement, but Jesus Christ can. If you want to be my follower, follow me. Do as I do. Christ's priority is the kingdom of God, and it should be yours. That's why he says in Matthew, seek first the kingdom of God. That the priority of your life as the Christ follower is to grow in relationship personally with the Lord and then seek others so they can do the same thing. That should be the priority of your 168 hours a week. That is the priority. The Bible says that you were created by him. Thank you. Someone say thank you, right? And for him. Can you still say thank you? It's a little bit of a stinger. I mean, Jesus was, he always raised the bar, man. Jesus was tough. You know, the Bible says you're not supposed to commit adultery. You know, husband and wife, you don't sleep around with another man or another woman. I get it. Jesus is like, yeah, that's not good enough. Yeah, if you look at some woman, you're a man and you're married, and you look at some woman and you're like, hey, baby, hey, whoa, whoa, whoa. That's already, you might as well, that's just as bad. He's always raising the bar. That's the way Jesus is. So he's like, don't just do as I say, but do as I do. The priority of your life should be the ministry of advancing God's kingdom in yourself and in other people. And during Christ's short life here in the flesh on earth, he taught some pretty hard-to-swallow lessons. And these lessons won't grace the pulpit of many churches because when you read them, it doesn't seem to be conducive to people going, yes, I want that. So when you preach God's grace and his love, and we're all feeling unloved, and we all need a break, and you preach grace and love, people flood the stage, and I get it, because we need it. But the job of the pastor, the job of the teacher is to teach the full counsel of God. And so it's in here. And if Jesus Christ can say it, I think I can too. So I know I can. Here's a few of them, and turn to Luke chapter, both of them are in Luke chapter 8, verses 19 through 21. And listen, those with ears to hear should listen. And there may be some in the room right now that are going to close their ears and not listen to Jesus Christ speak to you. You sang, Spirit of the living God, we're hanging on every word. You made that claim, and now he's about to speak. Luke chapter 8, verse 19, Jesus' mother and brother come to see him. He's got a big ministry going on. He's a rock star in the Middle East. Crowds are following him like crazy. And his mother, his family shows up. Like, Joseph got the diss again. Like, no one ever talks about Joseph. Poor Joseph. But Jesus' mother, Mary, and his brothers show up. They come to see him. But they couldn't get to him because of the crowd. And so someone tells Jesus, hey, your mom and your brothers are outside, and they want to see you. No big deal, right? That's nice. And so what does Jesus say? Does he say, yeah, come on in, man, come on in? He doesn't say that. Jesus replies, my mother and my brothers are all those who hear God's word and obey it. I am not by any stretch trying to squash the importance of your blood family. But I am telling you the words of Jesus Christ are clear. that when you talk about blood is thicker than water, we're talking Jesus' blood here. And what he did on the cross at Calvary to bring people together that are not naturally related is stronger than any other family you have. There's priorities here. And we get wrapped up in our own personal families doing this and this and that and protecting and producing and providing for our own little family. And Jesus is like, yeah, no doubt he loves his mom, right? Anyone going to argue that one? No doubt he loves his brothers. But what does he say? And I'm going to say it right now. And my family's in here. Every single one of you is just as important as my own blood. Because my blood is not the most important. Jesus Christ is. And you're my family, and I love you. I mean it. I mean it. Here's another one. Luke 9:57. You there? So he's walking along, right? That's what he does. He walks. Roger's like Jesus, he walks. He's Christ-like. Go, Roger, go, Roger. As they were walking along, someone said to Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. So what's he saying in effect? I want to be a Christian. And if you're in here tonight, maybe that's what you're saying. I want to be a Christian. Or maybe I am a Christian, I'll follow you wherever you go. And so Jesus replies, he doesn't just say, oh, great, let's do it, join the club, sign here. He says, Jesus replies, foxes have dens to live in and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place even to lay his head. He said to another person, come follow me. And the man agreed, but he said, Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. But Jesus tells him, let the spiritually dead bury their own dead. Let the dead bury their own dead, some translations will say. Your duty is to go and preach about the kingdom of God. Another said, yes, Lord, I will follow you, but first let me say goodbye to my family. But Jesus tells him, anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. These are massive priority statements right here. And he is invading some sacred areas of our lives. And you got to admit it. He's saying, listen, if you want to be my follower, Christ's followers follow me, right? He says, you want to be my follower, follow me. He says, listen, if you want to be my follower, you might not necessarily be homeless, but you better be willing to offer that up on the altar. You might, at very least, you might not have all the material gain and wealth and the admiration of all the people because you're my follower. Are you ready and prepared to give up some of that stuff for my sake? Would you do that for me? That's a tough one in America, isn't it? That's, I think, of the three, that's the easiest. He says, come follow me. And the man says, yeah, I'll follow you. Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. Like if you've lost a loved one, like that's brutal, right? Is he saying you shouldn't attend a funeral? Or is he just saying, listen, priorities, man. Priorities. See those people out there? He says to this guy, see those people out there that don't know me? Before they're in that funeral, before they're in that box, you can't help the dude in the box now. Priorities. Go tell the ones who are still breathing. The dad, if he's dead, that's unfortunate. We should grieve. We should grieve well. We should come alongside those that are grieving. But what does Jesus Christ say here? Let the dead bury the dead. Your duty. No one wants to hear about duty in the church. I'm talking about, not the funny word, I'm talking about duty. Everyone wants to hear love and grace and he's loved you so much you want to go do this. No, your duty. Your duty. You are created for him. Your duty, your reasonable service is go proclaim the kingdom of God. That's what we're to do. Nobody wants to hear it, but it's true. That's your duty. It's right there. I didn't make it up. Another says, yes, Lord, I'll follow you, but first let me say goodbye to my family. And Jesus is like, anyone who puts a hand to the plow, anyone who says, yes, I'm in, I want to follow you, but then he takes a turn and starts to do something else rather than follow, Jesus is not fit for the kingdom of God. Maybe this is why it's difficult. Maybe that's why the Bible says that the road to heaven is narrow. and that most people are not finding it. And most people that say that he is Lord are not finding it. There's a day that's coming that people will say, Lord, Lord. He's going to go, who are you? The road to heaven is narrow, and few people are finding it. Your priority, your duty, is to advance the kingdom of God, not taking care of your own stuff. The priorities of Christ must be the priorities of the Christian. Now, to look at the last thing that we're going to look at tonight, I'm going to invite you to go to the next chapter of Luke. I appreciate your patience and your willingness to hear the Word of God. I know I'm taking a long time. I'm not going to make an excuse for it, and I appreciate that you want this. Remember, I spoke to you earlier about really wanting to meet with the Lord, and here's His Word presented before you, and I pray that this will all be taken with and combined with faith so that it creates some change in your life. The other thing, as you're turning to chapter 3 that Jesus mentions, I forgot this one thing, I'm so sorry, is that he shows us the obedience. Verse 50, but they didn't understand what he meant. Remember what he said about the temple? Of course I'm here. Why would you even think? And it says that they didn't understand what he meant. I am who I am. You just don't understand me. And so we have our own little rules and we do our own thing. And yes, we're uniquely wired, and the Bible says we're fearfully and wonderfully made, but God's word trumps all that. Being about the Father's business means keeping God's commands. And he knows, Jesus knows, and you all know the Ten Commandments, and number 5 is honor your mother and father. And so he does that. He honors his earthly mother and father because he's about his Father's business. So even though he may not have, in our flesh, we may not want to do something, but if we're about the business of the kingdom, then we will obey the kingdom's laws. And the law is honor your mother and father. God's word says in John 1:12 that if you believe in Jesus Christ and accept him as Lord, then you are a child of God. So just as Jesus knows God the Father is his Father, and therefore obeyed the Father's command to honor Mary and Joseph, we too, as children of this same Father, must obey his commands. That's the life of the Christian. The Christ follower follows Christ. So we know who Jesus is. He's fully man, he's fully God, and that's a foundational doctrine of the faith. You got to have it. We know that Jesus taught what he taught, that God's kingdom before all other things. God is my priority, and I will obey his commands. And then the last thing here in Luke chapter 3, to land the plane, we see in Luke chapter 3, verse 7, it says this: the crowds were coming to John for baptism, and he says, again, another awesome church growth expression. He tells everybody, you brood of snakes, who warned you to flee God's coming wrath? Now, this may be the word that you might need for tonight. This might be your word right here. Prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sins and turned to God. Don't just say to each other, we're safe, I'm good, because we're descendants of Abraham. They thought that just because I'm Jewish, I'm good, I'm chosen people, I'm good. And clearly it says, no, you're not good. Okay? That means that nothing, for I tell you, God can create children of Abraham from these very stones. Even now, the axe of God's judgment is poised, ready to sever the roots of the trees. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be chopped down and thrown into the fire. Listen, you got to make up, you got to figure out what that means. I think you do. The crowds ask, well, what should we do? And so John replies, if you have 2 shirts, give one to the poor. If you have food, share with those who are hungry. Even corrupt tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked, teacher, what should we do? And he replies, collect no more taxes than the government requires. What should we do? Ask some soldiers. John replies, don't extort money or make false accusations. Be content with your pay. Does this sound familiar? What did Jesus say? If you want to be my follower, turn from your selfish ways. That's exactly what he's saying to these different people. Don't think about yourself. You got to turn to me. Your focus must be on me at all times. I must become the priority of your life. Everyone was expecting the Messiah to come soon, and they were eager to know whether John might be the Messiah. John answered their question by saying, I baptize you with water, but someone is coming soon who is greater than I am, so much greater that I'm not even worthy to be his slave and untie the straps of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Theologians fight about the fire part. I'm not going to give you an answer about the fire part because I don't have a clear indicator in Scripture of exactly what that means. But I do know this. John baptizes in water as a symbol that we're going to act different now. And that's awesome. Show with your life that you've actually repented and changed. But Jesus Christ baptizes you with the Holy Spirit to provide you with a moral compass and the Spirit to empower you to actually pull this thing off. That's the difference between what John's doing versus what Jesus is doing. Ephesians 1:13 says that when you believed, Christ gave you the Holy Spirit. So listen, loved ones, if you've said yes to Jesus, you've been infused with the power of the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead. And people are broken, and they're lost, and they're hurting, and people are scared, and people are filled with shame. And John the Baptist can look out over the brood of snakes, and he can see all these people that are hurting and broken and full of shame and scared and don't know what to do. And he can talk about Jesus all he wants, and he can point them to Jesus. And I can stand here, and I can look out over people, and I can see shame and fear and worry and hurt and brokenness. And I can talk to you about Jesus, and I can point you to Jesus, but only Jesus can give you the power to break addictions, to set captives free, to give sight to the blind, to save your soul and to mend a broken heart. Only Jesus Christ can do that, and only Jesus Christ alone. That, my friends, is what Jesus Christ does. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of Man. Jesus is Creator. Jesus is the Sustainer. Jesus holds all creation together. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Savior. Jesus is the way. He's the truth and the life. And no one gets to the Father except through Him. Jesus is the head of the church. Jesus is our high priest. This is who Jesus is. But who do you say that He is? He is Lord. He is Lord. I'm going to call the worship team back up, please. Christ followers follow Christ. There's no U-turns. There's no back roads. There's no excuses. There's no weak ways out of it. Like, that's it. So you've come to church and you didn't hear anything that would maybe make you feel better, but I'm telling you the truth. Because if we're going to worship Christ in spirit, you got to have some truth. And this is who the Bible says that Jesus Christ is. A lot of us can say who Jesus is, but the sovereign Father spoke from heaven and said, "This is my Son, do as he says." And Jesus' priority was advancing the kingdom of God. Didn't you know I'd be at church? Didn't you know I'd be learning and studying and sharing and teaching God's word? Do as I do. That's what Jesus said. Do as I do. Say yes to me. And I'll give you that same Spirit that led me through every moment of my life here. I'll give that same Spirit to you so you can follow me. And listen, if you're a Christ follower and you've tried to follow Jesus, it can be kind of tough, right? Yeah. I love my charismatic sister, but I don't know who you are, but I love your passion. But it's hard. And if you keep trying on your own to do it and you fail, you get miserable. Right? I'm preaching my mirror now, right? So he says, if you want to be my follower, follow me. But the only way to do it is to, to let me infuse you with my spirit so you can do as I ask you to do. That's the only way to do it. So I just ask you one last time before I step away. I'm not trying to scare anybody, but I don't know what tomorrow brings. But so you've been presented with some truth of God's word, telling you who Jesus Christ is. If you've never said yes to the lordship of Jesus in your life, now's the time to do it. No better time than present, right? If you've been kind of on the fence right here, like you believe in Jesus, but you're really not following Jesus, then maybe Jesus kind of was your savior, but he wasn't your Lord. Maybe you feel his hand on your back. Maybe it's time to stop playing the fence with Jesus Christ and get on the dance floor, right? And follow him. So just because I may never get, who knows, I might not see tomorrow. I might not get another chance to ask you. Who do you say Jesus is? It's the most important decision you will ever make in the life that Jesus gave you. Make it a good one. Say yes. Give your life to Jesus. If you want to make that choice tonight, I'd love to know about it. If you make that choice at another time after you leave, still would love to know about it. Just let me know. Hit me up. All right? I love you all. Thank you.